86 Mix.
Jack the Beat Godfather. Jack the Beat Godfather. Father Jack the Beat Godfather.
Godfather.
Jack the Beat Godfather. Jack the Beat Godfather. Father Jack the Beat Godfather.
Hi, this is Dave Pearce. Tonight on Six Music, we're bringing you a special edition of the Six Mix. This week, house music lost one of its founding fathers, legendary DJ and producer Frankie Knuckles, a man described by many as the godfather of house. He was 59.
Godfather. Godfather. The Godfather.
Hi, I'm Giles Peterson. I was devastated to hear of the news of the passing of the legendary DJ and producer Frankie Knuckles this week. He'd only just been in the UK to DJ, and so sad to hear of his passing. He has had such a huge impact on dance music from the early days at the warehouse, his work with Larry Levan, and forming what has become a phenomenon in music over the last four decades.
Hi, my name is Derek May. Frankie was a friend, a big brother, in many ways a mentor, and a great example of a man, which is more important than anything. Musically speaking, you cannot compare the mind of a man like that with anything, with anyone. The loss of such a beautiful mind affects everyone worldwide, and it truly will be felt. There is responsibility for everyone to try to pick up the pieces.
Later on in the day, it kind of struck me how much of a huge person he was, and how he really was the foundation of it. Mr. Frankie Knuckles, you'll be missed.
Come on, come all HOUSC, the Godfather of House, come see, brought a new era of sound. Worry now, getting down something like things brown. The man who taught you to sweat and jack now has the thing was deep on the track. At the warehouse, the walls came down. His name filled the air, got house off the ground. Frankie, Frankie, the crowd did chant. Step into his shoes, you can't. Slave to the rhythm, your body in bondage. The Godfather, time to pay homage. Go into the auto, the biography. Author, narrator, roast beef. P-U-M-P up like a tank. Name Knuckles, first name Frankie.
I first got to know Frankie at the start of his career 30 years ago and watched him earn his place in music history. Well, over the last 5 or 6 years, as various books and magazine articles were written about the early Chicago scene, often by people who weren't there at the time, I decided I wanted to get the chance to pin Frankie Knuckles down and record his own memories and recollections of that period in his own words, and find out what had really influenced Frankie in his house music creations. Finally, after much trying, we did get the opportunity to sit down together in a studio in London and make that program on BBC Six Music. We spent a joyous afternoon digging through tracks and reminiscing about his incredible music journey. As you'll hear, Frankie was on great form. His famous beaming smile was in full effect as he told us about some of his career highlights and shared his passion for the music that influenced him. As we come to terms with this tremendous loss this week, tonight, as a tribute, we're rebroadcasting that show as it first aired. And we kick things off with Frankie Knuckles and Jamie Principle and Your Love.
Thank you.
That's Frankie Knuckles, Your Love from 1987 on Chicago's Trax Records, featuring Jamie Principal on vocals. A track that was part of the birth of a new era of clubbing here in the UK and, of course, around the world. But Frankie Knuckles' journey starts way before that and before we heard his music in the UK. Welcome to Six Music, Frankie Knuckles. Good to see you again.
It's good seeing you too. Thanks for having me.
It's great for me because we actually first met really at the beginning of your career as a house music artist when you came over to the UK for the first time when I was working on a radio station called Radio London. And this new music was coming out of America, which was just completely different from anything that we'd heard before. Over here, I was playing soul and jazz funk. That was the kind of music that was happening in the UK. So it was a bit of a shock to the system for a lot of people when house music first emerged. But I want to find out, what were the ingredients of house music? How did you come up with this new sound? Because you're the man sort of credited with inventing it.
It wasn't anything that was premeditated or, if you will, trying to create something or, you know, as so many people try to do. It was, it all came from me basically just trying to keep my dance floor interested in coming to that club every week after disco was declared dead.
Yeah.
And when they announced that disco was dead, all of a sudden, immediately, the only music that was left was either rock and roll, serious R&B, or country western. I was already playing R&B, so it was fine. It was just a matter of me just refashioning it so that it can fit the dance floor and work well for me. Country western, forget about it. I wasn't about to go there.
Good, thank you. Me too.
Rock. I was not about to touch it. So, you know, I mean, I figured I would do well to just work with what I knew. And so there was a lot of different music that I was already playing, which was a lot of Philly soul. You know, I was beginning to learn how to edit and cut tape and things, if you will. A friend of mine who was in school for sound engineering hung out at the club with me every Saturday night. And when it came time for him to learn how to splice and cut tape and something, he would always ask me for different records just so that he could cut this stuff, you know, for a class and everything.
Yeah.
And what happened was the first song I gave him was So Fine by Howard Johnson. And he did such a phenomenal job with it that that's what made me really want to get into it.
So for people that obviously have been brought up on 12-inch singles and that, they're probably thinking, what's going on here? So before 12-inch singles really came along, you wanted to have your own extended edits of records that already existed. A lot of records were just on the 45 7-inch singles, as we called them here. So you would have a reel-to-reel machine in the DJ booth with you, and you'd actually cut your own sort of version of the track to extend it and make your own mix of it.
Absolutely. And actually, really long before that, I mean, before I even knew how to really manipulate a tape machine that way, I mean, you know, you had to really be on your job, you know, because you'd have 2 7-inch singles and you had to stay focused with what you're doing. Once 12 inches came along, it made it easier for guys to just put it on and just kind of step back, because the song is no longer a minute and a half, 2 minutes stops. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Could you imagine getting a song that's like 3.5, 4 minutes long and everybody's thinking, wow, it's really, really long.
Yeah.
You know, it's only like 3.5, 4 minutes, you know, compared to today. I mean, I've done some epic remixes of my own that have been like 9 minutes long, you know, which is crazy. That didn't happen back then. But by the time I got around to really cutting tape and editing things, I did it out of necessity. You know what I mean? Because there were no more disco records being made, nothing with any kind of real energy other than what was coming out of Europe and
I was going to say, because
there
was a massive backlash against disco in America, but of course here in Europe it continued. A lot of good music coming out of France and Italy and places like that. So some of that music translated into your mix that you were
absolutely playing. Well, I mean, I was doing a lot of shopping, you know, for a lot of imports, and I actually started working at a record store in Chicago called Imports Etc., and that helped keep the energy relevant and, you know, in the warehouse, and me being able to stay on top of things, and it kept fueling the audience, and they kept coming back because I'm playing music that they couldn't find anywhere else.
Which I think is why dance music exploded and became so exciting. And that has changed, but its exclusivity is a hard thing to come by. We're going to talk about that later on, but we want to get lots of music away. Now, you've picked the Detroit Spinners as one of the records that sort of influenced you pre-house music. It's a shame. Why have you picked this?
It was one of those songs when I first started hanging out as a kid that was really, really relevant. You know, I mean, these songs were just made with energy. And man, you can dance to them, and everybody got into them.
It's a shame the way you mess around with the man. It's a shame the way you hurt me. It's a shame the way you mess around with the man. I'm sitting all alone by the table.
And it's a shame. This is Dave Pearce on Six Music. It's nice to be back on this network. Delving into the last 40 years of dance music, I'm with DJ legend Frankie Knuckles, and dead excited to be back in his company. Frankie, I wanted to talk about your early DJing career. Actually, tell us about the Continental Baths as well. Now, I think this is interesting because you can explain what the Continental Baths was and how, you know, where this music came from.
Officially, Continental Baths was a bathhouse.
Yeah.
In every sense of the word, it was a bathhouse. The gentleman that owned it, Steve Ostro, used to be an opera singer. And it was his dream to open up an entertainment complex. But he opened the bathhouse first, and then he incorporated the entertainment. You know, so when he built the place, it was more than just a bathhouse. You know, there was a boutique. There was an Olympic-sized swimming pool. There was a theater room. There was a salon. I mean, it was a world unto itself. I mean, once you entered that building, a lot of people would check in on Friday night and they wouldn't check out until Monday morning, and they were on their way to work. But, you know, you could stay there. You can do some anything and everything and not have to worry about what's going on outside in the rest of the world. So
it was essentially a meeting place for gay men, and they had,
but on Saturday nights, yeah, it was a little bit different because he started incorporating all these shows. And that's where Barry Manilow and Bette Midler pretty much got their start. I mean, they were staples there. He was, Barry Manilow was her music accompanist, and she was the only woman that was in there.
Yeah.
You know, she was such a character and such a jokester. You know what I mean?
So, how many people were there? I'm just trying to envisage this building. So the area where the entertainment was then, was that like what you'd, like a small club area?
Well, it's like you came down in the basement and the whole basement had been gutted out. And it was a pretty nice size because when you got to the foot of the stairs, the first thing you saw was the DJ booth and the dance floor. And to the right of that was the stage for the cabaret. And then as you came around, you know, the salon was right there. Next to that was a full Nautilus gym, you know, and then there was showers, steam rooms, so on and so forth. And then there was the Olympic sized swimming pool in front of that. But as you came along past that, you know, there was a boutique and then the restaurant. And then there was an area that led you into the back where all the private rooms were. But that also brings you full circle to where the dance floor and the DJ booth was. And directly across from the booth, you have to see, what you see is the Olympic swimming pool and then the waterfalls over the pool and everything. It's really quite beautiful.
So you had all that music going on in there. And it's interesting because in the UK, the place you went to hear all the best new music was always the gay clubs. Do you think that was true in America as well? Oh, that was the gay bars.
Absolutely.
Has that always been how it was for you as well, do you think?
Absolutely. For the longest time, it really, really was. It's not now, but for the longest time, it really, really was.
Why do you
was.
Think it was, though?
You were hearing music unlike you had ever heard anywhere else before. You know what I mean? And in the gay community, a lot of times, you know, DJs would gravitate towards songs and music that you just didn't hear on the radio or commercially or in a straight club, if you will. It was just completely different. And DJs didn't mind taking risks and taking chances, you know, because they're discovering new songs and introducing new things, you know.
So people are less likely to walk off the dance floor. One of the dilemmas of a DJ is keeping your floor filled. So you found that crowd is more receptive to new music.
Absolutely. Just to give you a prime example of, one of the greatest mistakes, a DJ happened to put on this one record. They thought they were playing the A side of a song by Gloria Gaynor. But they were playing the B side and it was a mistake. And that song is one of the biggest records today.
Yeah.
I Will Survive.
Yeah.
And there was a lot of that went on. Guys just didn't mind taking risks.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, she put out a song called Most of All. And at normal speed, it just didn't sound right. So everybody started playing it at 45.
Wow. You know? That's pretty drastic.
Exactly.
Going from 33.
Exactly. But, you know,
you're not
I mean,
pitching
that's
it up
kind
here.
Of yeah. But that's the kind of imagination that, you know, a lot of DJs, especially in, you know, in the gay community had back then.
Yeah. Well, look, let's pick another record from your early days, and a record that you went on to remix. In fact, I actually played your remix on here a few months ago. But this is First Choice. And why have you picked this?
Well, it's the first professional remix I ever did. And it's interesting because I played that record in the warehouse for like about 4 years before I actually got asked to do the remix. Yeah. And then they held it up in production for so long after it was done because they didn't think I had enough of a name that people would want to hear it. So what they did was they held up the production on it for Shep Pettibone to have time to get his mixes done.
Right.
And then they put him on the A side and they put me on the B side.
Wow. Well, good company to be in that time.
Hey, I love Shep. Shep was a very close friend of mine. Yeah.
Yeah, cool. Yeah. And so,
but everybody starts somewhere.
But so when you were playing this record, were you, as a DJ, were you going, I'd love to remix this. I'd do this with it.
What it was is that I had been playing, it was an album cut. They had no designs on putting it out as a single. But I was playing it so much at the warehouse for all those years, long after the album had, you know, been put away. And it got back to the label that the song is huge at the warehouse and stuff like that. And so they was like, well, we'll throw him a bone. We'll let him do it. And then once they heard what I did with it, they was like, oh, yeah, this is really, really great. And so they was like, well, we just need somebody with a name now to mix it. And then, you know, it'll be a perfect package when they put it out. And it was all about Shep Pettibone at that moment in New York City, you know. So they gave it to Shep. He did his master mix. And ta-da.
Well, here's the tune. Here's First Choice.
I'm surprised to see your suitcase at the door.
First choice, Let No Man Put Us Under. This is Dave Pearce on Six Music, hanging out with Frankie Knuckles, digging through his record collection. We'll be delving into some of his remixes a bit later on, and finding out how he tweaks those knobs and what inspired him on the remix duty. But I'm sort of looking at the early days of dance music and how we got into house. We mentioned Europe briefly earlier on, so you spent quite a lot of time see what was going on the other side of the Atlantic.
Well, obviously, I wasn't traveling back and forth then. I wasn't doing any traveling at all, as a matter of fact. You'd be lucky if I make it to the garage every other weekend in New York, you know, and go record shopping. But because I worked in a record store.
Yeah.
And all the imports that came in.
Well, you didn't, All the vans come in with all the latest tracks. So whereabouts was that you were working?
It was in Chicago. It was called Imports Etc. And it was downtown in Chicago in the financial district. And a friend of mine owned the shop. And because he used to hang out at the warehouse all the time, he asked me if I would be his unofficial buyer. Because people would come to the warehouse on Saturday night and I'd play something, and immediately they'd go running out looking for it. And they would immediately run to his store, you know, because they said, well, this is where Frankie buys all his records from. So they must have it there. You know, so officially, unofficially, he brought me in as, you know, as the buyer of the store.
What was exciting about those times, I think, is, and you've explained that pretty well, is that pre-internet and everything like that, there were maybe sometimes, in your country, there might be only 50 copies of a record from Europe. The same happened here. You know, I would spend my time in a record store not far from here in Soho called Groove Records, and we would sit there and the vans would come on a certain day. You'd hope that if you knew them well enough, they'd keep one under the counter for you.
Right.
And, but if you had
if you were one of the A-list guys, they might save one for you.
Yeah. And then, but then if you had it, people could only hear that record if they came to see one of your sets. There was there's just no other way they were going to hear it.
There's a certain romanticism about that, if you were the lucky guy to get a copy of some of these records. But, you know, Chicago wasn't New York. But thank God for the internet, because we're all on the same page now. But back then, a certain great record would come out and two or three stores in New York City might get, I don't know, anywhere between 50 to 100 copies of that particular song. You know what I mean? Maybe because that's how they ordered it, whatever the case is. But in Chicago, you'd be lucky if the store would be lucky if you get 5 copies.
Wow.
And, you know, if I ordered them, I tried to order as much as I could because I knew. But before I started working there, they would try to get as much as they could, and they'd be lucky if they got 2 or 3. Mm. By the time I started working there, because I knew that there were other DJs in the city that was going to want it, I would order in greater numbers. But a lot of times they still would just only send me like maybe 5 or 10 copies.
So the record stores were just so vitally important, you know, sowing the seeds of the scene that we know and enjoy today, and that journey into house music, which we're going to be talking about next. But first, you picked Martin Circus, Disco Circus. Why have you picked this?
It was such a staple at the warehouse at the time, and I think every major dance club across the United States. If it was all about your club in your city, that was the song that drove the whole evening.
It's got a hell of a groove. Turn this one up.
BBC Six Music.
The Six Mix. Six Mix.
Thank you.
Martin Circus and Disco Circus. This is Dave Pearce on BBC Six Music, hanging out with my DJ buddy Frankie Knuckles, the godfather of house music. We've got MFSB on the way. Also Marshall Jefferson. We're getting into the early days of house music in just a minute.
This is Iggy Pop
on BBC Radio 6 Music.
What I've tried to do in these shows is to theme each show just really for the fun of having something to provoke a little conversation about the music, instead of subjecting someone to mood music for their entire Sunday afternoon when they may not be in the mood. This week's theme is revelations, songs that involve someone suddenly realizing where they are, who they are, what they lost, what is possible. That's what we're doing here. So join me, Iggy Pop, for Revelations. Sunday afternoon from 4 on BBC Radio 6 Music.
Six Music. Music.
You're listening to The Six Mix here on BBC Six Music. This is Dave Pearce with a Frankie Knuckles special, hanging out with the man himself and delving through his record collection.
Hi, Dave. How you doing?
That's MFSB. Love is a message. That reminds me of UK Pirate Radio. I used to be on a radio, well, a couple of them, actually. Radio Jackie was one, which went on to become JFM. And I used to run one from my house as well, and we used to play some of these tunes. So, MFSB, why did you pick that?
Well, actually, it's part of my humble beginnings into the music business. When I used to work for Nicky Siano at the gallery, I remember the night this person from Philly International actually came in and brought the record. And it was a white label. And that Nicky played that record all night long. It was all the talk, you know, love is the message, and it became the theme of the club.
Okay, well, beautiful, beautiful record. We're going to talk now about The Warehouse in Chicago. Tell us about that club then and why it was special.
They didn't really want me first. They wanted Larry first at The Warehouse. And at the same time that they wanted Larry, Larry was playing at a place called Reed Street, which was the predecessor to Paradise Garage. But, you know, the plans were being made for Paradise Garage and being built for Larry. And, of course, Larry had no intention on leaving New York City. They're about to build this super club for him.
Yeah.
You know, and it's the first of real, you know, especially after our super clubs ever. And the whole thing was being custom designed to his specification. It's amazing when they were doing it, you know, the sound system was put in the room and then the room was built around it.
Yeah. So this is, we're talking about Larry Levan here for people that have just tuned in, and the Paradise Garage in New York, which was, I was lucky enough to go there as well. And it was a stunning sound system.
It was Mecca.
I mean, you just breathed the music.
It was Mecca. When you walked in there, you knew it was someplace special.
Yeah.
And no one had ever seen anything like that back then. So. Yeah.
So let's talk about The Warehouse, though, which is where you were in Chicago, because a lot of people are saying that's where the name house music came from, because it was the records that you were playing at Warehouse. Is that a fair
story?
Yeah. I mean, well, I'm trying to get everything right here, because we read all these different books, and you were the guy.
As best as I know it, you know, when I started hearing, you know, the kids that were hanging out there calling it the house and stuff like that, I'm like, well, what are you talking about? And then it was like The Warehouse, 206. They either called it the house or they called it 206, which is the address, 206 South Jefferson Street. And that's pretty much how they referred to it. Hmm. You know, but what I was trying to tell you before was they originally wanted Larry to come out there and do the grand opening and ultimately take a residency there and move to Chicago. Larry had no intention on doing it, so I was second choice.
Well, it worked out all right.
Yeah, you know, I mean, I was interested in going. I had never left New York City before, but I wasn't interested in taking the job unless they had some kind of incentive involved in it. It just didn't, you know, I'm a real New Yorker at heart, you know, and real New Yorkers at heart don't get up and leave. But I got up and I left, only because they gave me a piece of the business. And, you know, to be 20 years old and you own a piece of your own nightclub, you know what I mean?
Wow,
the only thing you have to do is do your thing. That's like every kid's dream.
Yeah.
But, when I got there, it all worked out really, really well. In the beginning, the crowds was coming, people were interested. And then I left to go home to New York to think about it. And in the process, about whether I was going to actually move to Chicago, they lost the audience. So when I got back there, there was nobody going there. So it was my job to get people back. And, you know, I started taking little jobs here and there in different taverns and bars and stuff like that around the city. And it would just pull people away from those places to The Warehouse, and then they would see that it was something unique and different that they had never. I mean, you know, before I moved to Chicago, all they had really were jukeboxes in every nightclub. You know what I mean? There were no real DJs playing anywhere, and the ones that were playing were living on the north side of the city, and they were mostly white. And all the black clubs and stuff like that, you know, and the Latin clubs, there were no DJs. It was only just jukeboxes.
Wow.
Yeah.
So let's look at the music you were playing then. In The Warehouse Club, we've heard about those influences, the Philly sound, you loved your strings, you loved the big songs, the great vocals and all of that. But actually, you know, my recollections of the early house records that, you know, the first ones that were coming in on Trax and all that, what I remember is the kind of quite raw edginess of the tunes. And I was starting to play hip hop at that time. That was just kind of emerging in the UK as well. And there was in a way, quite a similar feel about it, because it was so, it felt like street music, I guess is how I would describe it. So how did those sounds evolve? Where did that come from?
I didn't really get into production until like maybe right after I did Let No Man Put Us Under for First Choice, and maybe 6 months, almost a year later, Jamie Principal walks into Imports Etc. and asked if he could meet me and stuff, because he wanted to have a word with me. And you know, he was a kid. He walked up and he asked me if I would be interested in producing him. And I told him that I wasn't a producer. You know, I just got lucky to do that remix and stuff. And he was like, well, I really like what you do, and I really wish you would consider doing it. You know what I mean? And that's what actually got me into producing. I mean, the fact that this kid thought that I could do it. So I just figured, okay, well, what the hell? I mean, you know, he's putting that much faith in me. Yeah. You know, I mean, what do I have to lose? But, you know, at the same time, while I'm working with him and I'm learning as I go, if you will, kind of on the job training, you've got all these other different guys, Jesse Saunders, Steve Silk-Hurley, all these guys that's all trying to do their own thing. They're trying to, you know, open their own clubs and fashion it behind the warehouse and what we did there. But they would do everything on a much smaller scale.
But why did that sound come out of Chicago, do you think? Because it was very much rooted in, you know, Trax or DJ International.
Well, it
Chicago
was, they,
was a sound.
A lot of those songs was based on the sound that came out of the warehouse, which was all that early Philly stuff.
Yeah.
You know, but at the warehouse, I mean, it was a house party. So, you know, you if you go to any real house party, you hear a wide cross-section of music. You know what I mean? It's never just one thing. You know, because it's a social atmosphere, so it's never everything is, you know, 130 beats per minute and four on the floor. No, you heard anything from rock to soul to gospel even. You know what I mean? That was how David Mancuso fashioned the loft when he first opened it. You know what I mean? And so it would be quite the journey that you go on all night long. And come morning time, you know, he might put something, like when it's close to time to go home, he might put something on like Here Comes the Sun by Nina Simone. Would change and adapt to just the mood in the room. And you really felt like you belonged to something really, really special.
Yeah. So we've been remembering, Frankie, some of those early clubs here at the loft and the power plant. And, well, you hooked up, I think, at the power plant with a certain Derek May, who gave you one of the first airings of a record that's widely regarded as one of the best moments ever in dance music. Tell us the story.
He brought me this track one night at the power plant. And he said, Frankie, this is something I just finished doing. And it was on a reel. And I had my reel-to-reel set up in the console. I listened to it, in the middle of while I was listening to it, I just mixed it right in. It's one of those moments where you hear something, you know, and I don't know if very many DJs do this kind of thing today, but, you know, you listen to it in your headphone and it just fits with what you're doing at that moment. And it was a risk doing it, but I just mixed it right into what I was doing. It flowed right into it and the whole room just went nuts and stuff. And then it played all the way to the end. I stopped it. I ran it back. I played it again. I did it like 3 or 4 times. Everybody was like, what is that? What is that? What is that? You know what I mean? And Derek was like, I was like, and I kept pointing to him because he was standing in the DJ booth. I kept pointing to him. And so he was like, so what are we? I was like, well, what's the name of it? And he was like, I don't know. What do you think we should call it? I was like, The Strings of Life. Because that's what it is. It's The Strings of Life playing.
Yeah.
You know, and he was like, okay, that'll work.
Wow. And of course that went on to
the next thing when it came out, it was called The Strings of Life.
Yeah, one of, I mean, a record that's dearly loved in this country and, you know, one of the greats. So let's stick it on. Here's Strings of Life. Strings of Life, Derek May, of course, making that amazing record. We were hearing about how Frankie named it whilst he was DJing. And I wonder if you get a royalty for that as well. I don't know. But the musical connection continues with Derek May because he gave you your first drum machine.
Well, at this point, I had my own club. I had left the warehouse and I had opened up the power plant. And there was always a caravan of kids that would come into the city from Detroit on Friday nights to hang out at the power plant. Friday night was our biggest night. And Derek May was one of those kids that would come down. And one Friday evening, he came in and he was like, listen, I just got these new drum machines. He was like, and I got one in my car. He was like, and I think you should really have one of these. Okay, why? was my question. He was like, listen, I think if you hook it up to your mixer and stuff like that, he was like, you can program your own beats and so on and so forth, and then you can incorporate it into what you're doing while you're playing, you know. And I just thought, okay, well, this should be interesting. Yeah, sure, fine. And he gave it to me, you know, and he hooked it up and he showed me how to program it and all the rest of the different stuff. And that was the first, I mean, and I never did anything with it other than just use it there in the club that way, you know. So, yeah. I mean, I'd be playing certain records and programming different beats underneath them and stuff like that, you know, and it was fun.
Yeah.
You know, but at the same time, you know, I'm now also working a little bit more with Jamie in production. And we're working on Your Love, as a matter of fact, you know. And then Jamie was like, you know, you should really let me borrow that drum machine so I can use it for Your Love. And so I was like, fine. And we was doing everything right there in that club. Your Love was actually recorded in the DJ booth.
Wow.
At the power plant.
Wow. So, yeah, I mean, it's sort of interesting, that whole notion of you then with your turntables, you're playing a drum machine sequence and sort of rearranging the track as it's.
Well, I would make segues. It would be, you know, just in case, you know, if you lose your train of thought, you don't know where you want to go. And so, like, hey, program a beat and throw it in there. You know, while you go flip through your records real quick and find something else to work with it. You know what I mean? And it would just keep the room going.
But it's funny, some of those early Chicago house records were quite clunky, weren't they? I'm not talking about your productions here, so don't...
Well, I had a few clunky ones, too. They just never saw the light of day. I was smart about that. Yeah. But the deal is that when all this focus was put on Chicago, all of a sudden, everybody came out of the woodwork and became a house artist.
Yeah.
And I remember it was at the New Music Seminar in New York City. And this was 1985, I think it was. And everybody was talking about house music in Chicago and this, that, and the other. And one particular journalist recognized me and pointed me out. And then all of a sudden, I'm surrounded by all these journalists from the UK.
Yeah.
And I was like, listen, if you guys want to come to Chicago, I'd be more than happy to host you and take you out and show you around and introduce you to everybody, this, that, and the other. I'm just trying to be nice.
Yeah.
Each and every one of them flew to Chicago after the New Music Seminar. And they all called me when they were there. I took them to meet Ronnie Hardy, Andre Hatchett, every DJ. I took them around to all the different studios where everybody was working out and introduced them to everybody. And then I just kind of stepped back. For lack of a better description, it's like all these journalists were like piranha and they were eating up everything they possibly could. You know what I mean? The culture, how people lived. I mean, how people just did anything and everything and everything that had to do with the music. And then all of a sudden, it's like everybody and their mother was a house artist and making a house record. And I'm trying to figure out, well, where's this coming from?
I think because we have a much more active music press in the UK probably than America, so everyone's always desperate to find a new thing. And this was something that was genuinely different. You know, nothing new had been around for a while.
And it was in its infancy.
Yeah.
You know, all the way across the board, it was in its infancy. But all of a sudden, you've got thousands of people making house records.
So the quality control, what you're saying is,
the quality control wasn't
always there, yeah.
Yeah, and most of it was garbage.
Yeah.
Most of it was garbage.
Okay, well, here's one that isn't garbage. We could play Marshall Jefferson, Move Your Body. Why have you picked this one?
Well, because it was actually the particular song that really defined what this is.
Six music.
Six mix. We'll be right back.
Move your body, 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 move
Rachel Jefferson, the house music anthem, Move Your Body. We're hanging out with Frankie Knuckles on Six Music. This is Dave Pearce with a Six Music special. And we're looking at Frankie Knuckles' record collection. Well, not all of it, otherwise we'd need a whole year, really. But picking some of the highlights from his illustrious career and looking at the early days of house music. So I'm sure there's lots of you out there getting all dewy-eyed, reminiscing about some of the clubs and nights that you went to. I particularly enjoyed this era of music. It was very exciting. Because the music suddenly got faster again, I guess. Certainly in the UK, we'd all slowed right down with that soul and jazz funk. And suddenly, you know, everything had just notched up a little gear. Yeah. So it was a good vibe, wasn't it?
Yeah, absolutely.
Happy.
Well, that was the scary thing that happened in the United States when they declared disco dead. All of a sudden, the energy was stripped right out of the music. And I think the main thing I was trying to do was just trying to keep the energy there, which is why I was recutting everything and layering different drum beats underneath, you know, and I was using a rhythm maker then to do that, you know, just to keep it fresh.
And how long were your DJ sets back then? You spoke earlier about this whole thing of creating this journey for the night. So what was your sort of average?
12 hours.
12 hours.
Wow. From midnight to 12 noon the next day.
Yeah.
But I mean, there were four occasions that I actually had a marathon, 24-hour marathons. And it was really for charity. And so basically what I did was I played for 24 hours. Four different times.
That must have been. Did you ever think,
I
played that one already?
I was young, stupid.
Yeah.
and insane. But, you know, I mean, I had a crowd that was just as young, just as stupid, and just as insane. So why not?
We're going to move on to another record from the Peach Boys now, Don't Make Me Wait. Now, I seem to remember when I went to the Paradise Garage, when it was Larry Levan there, you know, I'm sure I remember him playing this
is his first production.
Yeah.
This is his group. This was his, you know, they were his artists, you know, and it was the first thing he actually produced on his own.
It was weird for me coming from the UK. At that time, what was strange was in the UK, all the clubs used to shut about 1 o'clock in the morning. So my first trips to New York, again, something that only got going at 2 or 3 in the morning. I mean, now, obviously, it evolved and we had rave culture and all that, but this was completely unknown to us. And I remember actually, going to meet Gwen Guthrie in there to do an interview. Mm-hmm. And I rang her agent, I forget what his name was, and I said, well, what time should I do? And they said, oh, about 5 in the morning.
Exactly.
I was like, what? And then it was great coming out of that club into broad daylight in the middle of the day. Everyone's going to work or at work, and you've been up all night in a bit of a state.
The way we grew up. That's the way we grew up. I mean, you never got to a club before midnight. You took a disco nap, if you will.
Yeah.
And you'd get up like about 3 or 4 o'clock in the morning, have your shower, get yourself together, have a cup of coffee, head straight onto the club. And then you'd dance until noon and sometimes well until, you know, the afternoon, depending on how, you know, how everything was going.
Yeah. I remember coming back to the hotel and the room service were looking at you a bit worried because they said, well, you don't actually sleep in this room. You're out all night. And then you just stick the do not disturb sign. Yeah. It was all right for you living there. Yeah. Let's hit up the Peach Boys thing. So we started talking about that. I haven't played it. So here's Don't Make Me Wait.
I want you to check it out. Another night.
Track from the Peach Boys and Don't Make Me Wait. As Frankie was saying, that was early Larry Levan. We were talking about Larry Levan and the Paradise Garage. And in Larry's records, what always interested me was every little sound is in there for a reason. And we were just talking during that record about how record production has changed, particularly with dance music and electronic music. Obviously, it's enabled a lot more people to make music at home, which is a great thing. But it's the same amount of craft and time spent in in how you make those records.
No. A song is written and then it's put together. You know, it was a collective effort. You know, the Peach Boys was a group, but it was Larry's group. You know, I mean, they were a bunch of musicians that used to hang out at the garage. And they had different ideas and demos that they would, you know, play for Larry. And then he eventually became, you know, the fifth person in that group. And his vision is what made them what they were. You know what I mean? And even when you listen to a song like that, I mean, if you listen to any mix Larry has ever done, Larry Levan has ever done, the one element that sticks out the most is the funk.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, he was the funk and the dark side about everything when it came to work. And I was, the stuff I do is a whole lot prettier. You know what I mean? But that was where his soul was right there in the funk and stuff like that. And he had a funky band there with the Peach Boys. And the leader of the group, Michael DeBenedictis, I mean, genius. You know, he had his vision. Larry had his vision for what he wanted to take. And they would get on their train and they would ride with him and stuff like that. You know what I mean? But it was a collective effort that made it happen. You know, it wasn't just Larry saying, here, give me the tracks and I'll just sit over here and I'll just do what I want to do with it. You know what I mean? It was all of them in the studio, in a room together, talking about what they heard and where they wanted to go and the keyboards there and, you know, bouncing different ideas off so it can come out exactly like what you heard.
Well, we've got a beautiful piece of music coming up next for, well, a guy I haven't seen for a long time, Robert Owens, I'll Be Your
Speak
Friend.
Of the Devil.
Yeah, great, great, great track. Tell us why you've picked this.
It's one of those classic songs from the Sound Factory. When I played the Sound Factory in New York, after I left the world, just after a couple of years being back in New York, I got the call to play at Sound Factory because Junior Vasquez had left. And there was so much incredible music that was born in that first year that I played there. This was one of those songs.
Such a beautiful, soulful vocal. That's Robert Owens and I'll Be Your Friend. We're digging into Frankie Knuckles' record collection here on BBC Six Music. Actually, I must say hi to a voice from the past around the time that, you know, I was hanging out with Frankie for a while. I was working at a record label called Urban Records, and this guy turned up one day without an appointment, a guy called Jimmy Polo. And he was from Chicago and he was trying to get a record deal. Couldn't get one in the States. So he came, anyway, he came into the office. He said, I'm from Chicago, kind of, and he knew that I liked Ten City and all that sort of stuff. He's going, oh, can I come see you? I was like, okay. And he said, yeah, I want to make a record. And I was like, okay, have you got the track? And he's going, oh, no, I haven't got a track, but I can sing it to you. So he just stood in the office. I said, well, go on, then sing it. And he sang Better Days, and which was great. So I was like, okay. So we put him in a a studio in London with Adamski, who was this keyboard player who went on to do all this wave things. And we made our own little attempt to sort of US sounding house music. But it was a nice little track. There's a great B-side of that. So Jimmy Polo, if you're listening, wherever you are.
I still speak to him to this day.
Do you? Oh, we have to say hi.
Yeah, he lives in Italy.
Does he?
Yeah, I speak to him all the time.
We're going to go into the Sounds of Blackness and The Pressure next. Sounds of Blackness, just awesome. And you got to get your remix treatment on Sounds of Blackness. Well, how did you get to work with them?
I wanted to remix Optimistic. And I called up the label and I was begging them to let me mix Optimistic. It was like, well, listen, we actually had something else in mind for you. It was like, we'd rather you do The Pressure. And I'm like, The Pressure's nice, but I would really rather do Optimistic. And they was like, no, Frankie, trust us. They was like, listen, do us this favor. They was like, remix The Pressure, and then we'll let you do Optimistic afterwards. So I'm like, okay, bet, no problem. So, you know, I got my crew together, and we went in, and we knocked it out. I mean, it came out fabulous. It really did, and I was very, very happy with it. And so now I'm thinking, okay, well, you've done this, so now you're going to get to do Optimistic. Optimistic had already came out while I was busy working on the pressure. And I was like, well, what about Optimistic? They was like, you don't need to do Optimistic. You just batted out of the ballpark with this. And I was so upset. I really wanted to do Optimistic, but between the two records, it was a better one.
Yeah. I mean, so, they're both great records. I mean,
yeah, they're both great, absolutely. But The Pressure made the biggest impact on the dance floor.
Yeah.
Between.
Do you get to talk to, like, because Jam and Lewis did the original production on the tracks, didn't they? So do you sort of get to speak to them about the route that you're taking? Or once it's headed over to the remix, do they just step away and they just go, wait, this is, do you have any communication with them?
Well, I did have some communication with them when it came to that particular song, because before that, they had did a song called I Can't Stand It. I don't know if you remember that. Mm. Great dancehall record, like back in the 80s and stuff. And so when I had done this record, I got a message from them about, you know, how thrilled and how happy they was with, you know, how it turned out and stuff like that. And it was like, you're still doing this house thing. And then you take a gospel record like that and you just really turn it into a club thing. I was like, I was trying to keep it church without, because I know a lot of people that are very religious in Chicago, and they're very, very funny about gospel music being played on dance floors. And so, and I was like, listen, people get the spirit in the middle of the night. They should be able to, you know, go there if they want to. And you've got a voice like that and a choir like that and a song like that, I was like, please, why not?
Absolutely amazing live as well, The Sounds of Blackness.
Yeah.
Just such
they're incredible.
Yeah, absolutely overwhelming incredible. Experience. All right, well, let's hear The Sounds of Blackness. Dance artist coming up next, someone I remember very much out on the rave scene in those mad days. Alistair Limerick, why have you picked this?
It's Where Love Lives.
It is.
Isn't that obvious?
Alison Limerick, Where Love Lives, Just Because. That's why we're playing it. Frankie, tell us about your connection with this tune and how you ended up working on a record from a British dance artist.
David and I were remixing everything here in the UK in like the late 80s, early 90s, and pretty much lived in Quiet Recording Studio. And this song came across our desk one day. I got to the studio and he was like, well, you have to hear the song that we just got to do. And he put it on. I was like, oh yeah, absolutely. Yeah, we definitely have to do that. I was like, when do we start? And so he was like, well, as soon as we finish this, we'll do that. And what actually we were working on at the time was, what you going to do with my loving for In a City? And so, you know, we couldn't wait to get to this particular song. You know, I think we both heard the same magic in it. And the way we worked in the studio is that it was a big 72-track SSL board. So David was at the top with all the percussion, bass line, that kind of thing. And I'm down at the bottom end of the board with all the harmonics and the pretty stuff. So the strings, the piano, yada, yada, yada. But going in, what we do is we always did our overdubs first. So David would go and program his drums. Then I'd go in and I'd work with all the musicians, you know, starting with the piano lines and stuff like that. And then building all the strings and everything else after that. And then we'd meet in the middle.
Well, those pianos, I mean, just it still works today, that record. Just a joyous moment on
the
dance
floor. It's a classic piano line.
Yeah. And as I was saying there before that, obviously Alison, that was kind of when the rave thing was going on here as well. So I was doing these raves.
Yeah, the rave thing came on the heels of all of this.
Yeah, this story in London. I remember having her on alongside The Prodigy. And I mean, I had on one bill, Alison Limerick, The Prodigy and Mannix and SL2, I think, all different styles of music, but it all kind of worked in one night.
Wasn't it the sum of love?
It certainly was. Well, I can remember of it. We've got an all-time favourite Frankie Knuckles track coming up, which is very special to me, in just a minute.
Dear class of 94, amazingly, it's 20 years since together we entered and influenced the mainstream.
And it's high time we gathered to celebrate the difference we all made. You're invited to our special Britpop reunion.
To remember our momentous formative years, to renew old friendships, to hear the music, and to share the memories, even those some of us would rather forget.
There'll be a host of parties across multiple venues, BBC Radio 2, Six Music and BBC Four. We'll be providing the entertainment and refreshments.
You'll just need to brush off your skinny tees, polo shirts and boots.
And join us for Britpop at the BBC.
Doors will open this weekend. Kind regards, Steve Lamack.
And Joe Wiley.
Six Music. A strong emotional connection with me, as a DJ on the dance floor, you've seen people like crying when this record comes
out. Well, you know, it's one thing to be on this side of the production of it, you know, and then also being the DJ that plays it in a nightclub, you know, but when people are actually reacting to it on the dance floor, you know, which is why I like playing in DJ booths that I'm so much closer to the dance floor, because at least I see and really feel everything that's going on. When I'm too far away from it, I don't feel like I'm a part of the party. And I had people come up to me and said, they're actually crying out there. People are really crying at how beautiful this song is and stuff, you know. And it kind of blows my mind a little bit, you know. There's certain songs I've worked on that it'll hit a note and I'll just break down in the booth, and I'll immediately have to just turn around just so people don't see it. And sometimes I get caught up in it.
I've done it as well.
Yeah. And sometimes people catch it, you know what I mean? Yeah. And I can't talk about it now because I'm about to go there.
You were also saying that record nearly was just an instrumental, but it was actually Judy at Def Mix in your management that said, no, you've got to put a song on there.
I wanted to keep it as an instrumental because it was so beautiful. But she was like, no, 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 you have to write a song to this. You have to write a song to this. And I was like, and at the time, Satoshi was still living in Tokyo. So I called Satoshi on the phone. I was like, okay, so we have to write a song to this. But I wasn't asking him to because he didn't really speak English. So I said to him, if you could have anybody sing on this record, who would it be? He said, Robert Owens. Well, Robert Owens happened to be my roommate at the time. I had moved Robert to New York because I was working on an album for him.
Yeah.
So I told Robert, okay, we need to write these lyrics for this song.
Well, it's a great, great piece, that. And it's always featured in my lists of all-time favourites. When you go on MTV or whatever and pick records, it's always in there. And it's just such a big anthem in the UK.
I really appreciate the people of the UK embracing that song the way they have, because it means so much more to the people here than I think it even does to me or Robert. You know what I mean? It chronicles people's lives, and people know exactly where they were at, and what it, you know, when they hear it, it just immediately takes them there.
So we're going to play the Whistle Song. Now, this is interesting because I think we meet again in the UK when this is actually came to do the promotion for that. By then I was on Kiss, which had been a pirate. We got a license, and we had London's first dance radio station. And this record was just completely different from anything we'd hoped for. So how did you come up with this?
I wanted something that was going to really, really be special and absolutely beautiful, but would engage people. And this was the first time that Eric and I was working together. You know what I mean? And he had the rhythm, you know, of the track basically laid out, you know, and I'm singing around different things and singing different ideas to him, which is pretty much how I work. You know, I get with a key, you know, with a keyboard player or program, and I sing every part, melodies, harmonies, you know, as best I can. And
you got a good range in your voice then, haven't you?
Well, no, I'm lucky because they're all, you know, they're all classically trained musicians.
Right.
And programmers on top of it. Can't beat it with an ugly stick. You know what I mean? So that's what made it easy for me. You know, and we started playing around with this idea, and then we started looking for the sounds for it. You know what I mean? And then when he started stumbling across that whistle, I was like, that'll work.
Let's just lose ourselves in this chair. Shut your eyes, and let's go on a bit of a journey. Frankie Knuckles and the Whistle Song, which I have to say on that radio station that I mentioned earlier, we did play this as a daytime playlist record, which in today's radio market seems completely unlikely how things have changed. But I guess people were a bit more free thinking in those days, and we were able to play lots more interesting records during the day. Luckily, we have some specialist stations like Six Music and the odd place where we can get away with it. But it is tough out there. Interesting, you know, obviously you're a DJ that DJs around the world, and I used to, as you know, come and see you at the Sound Factory bar in New York, and you very kindly used to let me in the booth next to you while you were doing your thing, and it was an amazing atmosphere there. But you had such a loyal following in New York in that club. I mean, the first few bars of any record, they knew exactly what it was. Almost before it came in. It was incredible, wasn't it? That must have been such a buzz for you.
It's unlike anything I've ever done in my life before. To work in a nightclub, well, one, you can literally be that close to people. As close as we are to each other right this minute.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? No one gets in your way. You know, no one disturbs what you're doing. They just let you be. You know what I mean? And they feed you energy all night long. And it's ideal. I think that's the ultimate for any club DJ, is to be able to have a room that caters to you that way. I mean, they built the sound system to my specifications. The crowd that came in there was there for what I could give them.
Yeah.
You know, no one ever asked a request of anything.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, every now and then one of those kind of people would get in there. And of course, you know, the room would really, really react wrong because, you know, if I have to give them that look.
He's doing the look now.
Anybody that was in front of the DJ booth knew exactly what time it was.
And if you saw somebody would don't even go there.
They were grabbing by the scruff of the neck, and then I don't see him anymore the rest of the night. So.
No, it was a wonderful atmosphere in there, and I loved going there to see that. Now, I've got another one of your tracks, and we will go and tell the people's music. I just had to play this because I haven't played this on the radio for about 20 years or whenever. I can't remember when it came out, but I think this is a great emotional connection with this record. So tell us about how you made this. It's Hard Sometimes.
It's the first song I actually penned alone, by myself. I collaborate with a lot of different lyricists and songwriters, but it's the first song I wrote by myself.
Wow.
On the first album. And Shelton Becton, his voice is just absolutely lovely. When Satoshi and I first wrote the music to it, I'm sitting there with pen and paper, and it just flowed. It just came right on out. That's what it sounded like it was saying to me. Mm-hmm. And then to get with Danny Madden and Shelton Becton, you know, when we were coaching him through how to sing it, he just nailed it the first time, right? He felt it. He understood it. He knew what it meant. That blew my mind, because it was the first time I've actually ever really did anything completely that way.
It was a very heartfelt performance on there, and you know, I think this is great. You know, a lot of people may be hearing this for the first time as we're about to play it. They won't have heard it before, but
it speaks, you know, it speaks to a part of everyone's
life. Everyone has a moment where they need a record like this to connect to, so let the record speak. Here it is.
Give up. One day you will find someone who will be kind.
Frankie Knuckles, It's Hard Sometimes, a track that's gives you some kind of optimism at the end of a difficult day as well. We're almost running out of time, which is a nightmare. I'm sitting here with all these Frankie Knuckles. We need about another 4 hours, please, BBC.
We need about another 4 weeks.
Yeah, well, that would be great. We haven't even got started yet, so we'll have to do this again, I think. So we're going to play Frankie Knuckles as he is today. You're sort of still DJing all around the world.
Yeah.
Aren't you tired? My God, you need to lie down, don't you?
No, I'm not tired of it at all. As long as I'm making music, you know, I have to play it. There was a long period that I didn't do anything at all. And what actually pulled me back into it was working on the song Blind for Hercules and the Love Affair. And at that particular point, you know, I had people saying, listen, I don't know why you're not doing this, but, you know, you need to get up off your ass and get back to work.
Robin, my producer, is getting very excited jumping up and down. He loves that work. If you hear this weird squeaking noise, it's his chair.
So that's what kind of jump-started the whole thing. And I'm working in a capacity now that works really, really well for me. I can appreciate what I do so much more now than I could before. I mean, there was a time where I was buried in the studio all the time, and you can't really appreciate what you do when you're going from one project to the next, to the next, to the next. And you know, so taking that period off, you know, and then getting back to it now, I mean, I'm working in a capacity that works well for me, and I'm having a great time with it.
So we're playing I'll Take You There. So it's got Jamie Principle on it.
Yeah, Jamie Principle. The thorn in my side. The vein of my... sorry, I'm just kidding.
So this is the last record. It's where we say goodbye to Frankie Knuckles. Thanks so much for coming in.
And thank you too. Thank you so much for having me.
Your music's influenced so many DJs and music fans around the world. So it's a great honour to have you here today and celebrate your music. And we can get this now.
Yes, it's out now on Nocturnal Groove.
Okay, here we go. This is Dave Pearce. You've been listening to a BBC Six Music special in memory of Frankie Knuckles, who sadly died this week. Frankie's music and legacy will live on forever. I was proud to know him. Thanks for the music, Frankie. I'll miss the smiles and the big hugs. You'll be missed. And thank you for listening.